Time for 10 in 10. So we'll try to do a quick 10-minute tour of all 10 regions of Ghana if we can. We know that it's the campaign season, and so politicians have intensified their campaign activities. We're heading over to the northern region, where our northern regional correspondent Zubeida Ismail is standing by with some news as far as campaigns are concerned in the northern region. Good morning, Zubeida Ismail.
Good morning.
Well, how are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
Okay, so just about a fortnight ago, we saw the massive campaign launch of the National Democratic Congress parliamentary nominee for the Tamale Central constituency. Since then, how many other campaign launches have occurred in the northern region?
I think after the campaign launch, we had the Tamale North NDC parliamentary candidate in the person of Al-Hassan Siyini also launching his campaign. We have the MP for Nansa, who is also the Deputy Minister for Trade and Industry, Musala Ibrahim, also launching his campaign. Yesterday, so we had the parliamentary candidate for the Yagba Kobori constituency on the basis of the NDC, who is also the chairman for the Hajdor. Al-Hajj Council also launching his campaign. We equally had the MPP parliamentary candidate for the Savulubu constituency, Mr. Samuel Gunu, also launched his campaign yesterday. And finally, we have the Deputy Minister for the Northern Region, Honorable Adrian Sutini, equally launching his campaign on Saturday. And so, apart from what happened about 2 weeks ago, we've gotten about 5 people launching their campaigns here in the northern region.
Wow, that's quite a number. So, do these campaigns differ in magnitude? You know, if we're doing a comparison between what we've seen now and what we saw just about a fortnight ago with the campaign launch of Alhaji Nusrat Fuseni, do they differ in magnitude, in sheer strength and size and participants?
Yes, I would say that since what happened in Tamale concerning the campaign launch of the Minister for Roads, Nusrat Fuseni, we've not seen much of money, or I wouldn't want to say that it's weak, because they wouldn't want to accept that it's weak. But this time around, we didn't see the life of Shatawale and Co. coming here to perform. We only saw lost in the northern region, and who is a known artist here in the northern region. And so when it comes to musicians and then the money that are spent on musicians, we can say that it has reduced, because so far, apart from innocent groups that had so many backlash, we haven't witnessed of music. Some didn't even get the services of musicians. It was just politicians coming to do their speeches, and that was just it.
I see. I'm glad you raised the subject of money, because, you know, in other campaign launches, especially from other regions of Ghana, there have been allegations and accusations of you know, money sharing or vote buying. Was this replicated in any of the campaign launches you've witnessed?
I personally, all throughout these campaigns that I have witnessed or that I have been part of, I've not physically seen anybody sharing money. Yes, you have seen pictures coming from the northern region depicting that incident, but I must say that all throughout the campaigns that I have been to, from Musale's campaign to ADA Fuseni to the NPP candidate to Yagba Kobori, I have not seen any such thing. We hear it in the air, but I have not seen, I have not come across any such thing so far.
What were the general themes or messages, you know, that were predominant in these campaign launches or during these campaign launches? We just spoke about a report. In fact, it's a study conducted by the NCCE, where respondents, you know, were primarily concerned about 3 areas of the economy: education, health, and employment. In that order, what were the themes, the messages that these politicians sent across to their constituents? Were they in line with these 3?
Yes, I will. That taking in consideration of what happened yesterday in Savulubu, where we have the running mate for the NPP presidential candidate, Dr. Mahmoud Daoud, they are telling electorates in the Sablon constituency that once they are voted into power, the veterinary college, the correspondence or in the district, will be upgraded so that it will be able to take more students and, of course, will be able to train these students to be able to offer better services when it comes to veterinary services. Now, when you look at the NDC aspect, we had the ambassador of Ghana to Saudi Arabia, Sinari, touting the developmental project the NDC have done for the country, taking into consideration the fact that they were able to fly some pilgrims from Tamale trips to Saudi Arabia. Ambassador Sinari, it is a great achievement, and that alone should let the Islam or the Muslim society keep or maintain the NDC in power. When you listen to the Deputy Minister Kopa, who is also the parliamentary candidate in the Yakutsk Savu constituency, Abu Jinapo, speaking at the campaign launch of Musala Ibrahim in Nassau, he also told residents that if they maintain the NDC, the few communities around that area that are not connected to the national grid will be connected to the national grid. And that promise, he made it saying that he is the power minister. Once he says you have power, you have power. And so the people should trust the NDC and maintain it. I think these have been the messages. On education, I have not heard much from the NDC when it comes to education, because to them, they say that they have built enough infrastructure, and so it is enough for the people to maintain it. But they have not actually told us any new thing they are going to bring on board when it comes to education here in the northern region. But the NPP yesterday, but that's about me, I was able to tell electorates that when it comes to Arabic, here is the northern region, and of course, it is an Islam dominated region. And so, students are taught Arabic from basic school to junior high school, but at the secondary school, they are not taught, it doesn't continue there. But they have the chance to continue Arabic studies in the university. And we believe that the gap from junior high, and then you don't get the training again in senior high, that will have to go and do it in the university. It doesn't fit. And so when the NDC comes into power, we'll make sure that at the senior high school level, Islamic study is going to be optional. And so if you are moving from the basic through to junior high and through to senior high, and you want to continue your Islamic study, you can do it. And what is going to be taught in the senior high school means that we are going to employ more of these imams to be teaching these students. And so we are going to get money into their pockets. And so when it comes to education, that is the new trend the NPP are preaching here in the northern region.
Are you in a position to tell if, you know, these constituents or some of these constituents are actually buying into some of these promises?
Yes, I can say that when it comes to what the Islamic aspect of it, people are actually buying into it, because here is a region where we have many people being sponsored by the Saudi government to go to Saudi Arabia to learn Arabic. And so when they come, they are only allowed to teach at the basic level. And so virtually, they do nothing when it comes to the senior high school. So to them, there is a mistake. And would or may decide to vote for the NDC when it comes to that. But like I said, the NDC is only telling us that they have built new schools, and so it is enough that the people maintain them in power. And then we don't know what new thing they are bringing. And so when you compare the education aspect, I want to believe that lecturers are buying into what the NPP is preaching more than what the NDC is preaching.
That's very interesting. Let's move away from politics to another social story. And this is quite an interesting one, because over the weekend, we saw drones in Rwanda delivering medical supplies, pints of blood, etc., to hospitals and wherever, you know, they needed help. We may not be doing the same now in Ghana, but I gather there's a family in the northern region that's trying to do the same. There's a family that's totally dedicated to donating blood.
Yes, when you look at this family, it is called the Alou family, and then this is a man with his three sons. And then Mr. Alo himself, since 1999, started donating blood. And since he began that journey, he's been able to inculcate that into his three sons. And Mr. Alo currently is the second highest blood donor here in the Northern region. Now, his son, his second son, who is called Sadiq, is also known as Shafiq, is the first youngest, highest blood donor in the Northern region. Now, when I spoke to Mr. Alo, he said that, people have been celebrated for so many reasons, but he wants his family, his house, to be known as the blood bank of Ghana. And so he's even ensuring that though he doesn't have grandchildren yet, but he's praying that once his grandchildren begin to come to the world, they will also take up what he and his sons are doing. All three sons of his are included. Now, I spoke to his last born, who is a girl. She's 17 years. And then this girl cannot wait to be 18 to also be able to join his brothers or his siblings when it comes to the blood donation. And so they are positioning themselves that they have nothing to offer. The only thing they have to offer is the blood that is in them. Which, to them, it has gone beyond a responsibility, but it is now a passion. It is their way of giving back to the world. So they don't have the physical cash to help anybody. But once they have the blood in them, that can save another person's life. They are willing to give that blood anytime, anyhow, when they need it.
So, you know, when I first heard the story, I thought, okay, perhaps it's not just their blood, but they also hold, you know, conduct some blood donation exercises and invite other blood donors. But I get the impression it's what they do, just them, their blood.
They apart from, they haven't organized blood donation exercises themselves before, but they are positioning themselves that any time they hear of any blood donation exercise going on in family, unless of course they have not been able to recover from their last donation, once they've been able to go through the normal relaxation time that you're not supposed to donate blood after you've donated one, they are willing to go. And so unless of course they don't hear it. And aside going to blood donation exercises, the PPH, I can say for a fact that have taken notice of this family, and anytime there is an issue and it has to do with blood and has to do with their blood, they would call them and they would go and get them wherever they are, bring them to the hospital and get the blood from them. And so aside going to blood donations, the Tamale City Hospital would always follow these people in this family for blood anytime there is a need.
But that means they have to ingest a lot of food and dietary supplements. Do they receive any aid or support from any organizations, governmental, non-governmental, corporate?
No, I think the only thing they receive is when they go and then the normal train of Milo and then few tins of milk and maybe a drink at that stop. I mean, that's the only thing they are getting. They feed themselves, they try to be healthy so that they will be able to do it. And there is a family that is still growing. And there is a family their head, that is the father, is a civil servant who earns just a peanut. But he's been able to make sure that he eats healthy food to be able to always give the blood when they need it.
Fantastic. This is the definition of selfless service to God and country. Thank you, Zubaida Ismail, our Northern Regional Correspondent, giving us the latest of happenings in the Northern Region. You're watching New Day, that ends at 4:10 and 10. We'll